We all have it. Some have more than others. It is very much a part of our daily life, and most of us would be quite irate if we ever lost our hair. Controversy is an ugly word, one you would normally expect to hear associated with the White House or Hollywood. But even here in our Salesianum community, we are not free from the icy clutches of controversy. I'm referring, of course, to the trial of the century. Yes, John Grenda, history teacher, Model UN moderator, and all-around good egg, is being sued by David J. Quinn, Model UN president, all-around good student, and all-around redhead, for breach of contract. For those of you who don't know, let's give you a brief history of this trial. Last February, the Model United Nations team went down to Washington, D.C. to compete in the 35th annual North Atlantic Invitational Model United Nations Conference.
Is there more?
Oh, sure.
There's more.
By this contract, Mr. Grenda promised that if the team took home the winning national championship trophy, he would shave his head.
We have with us in the studio today a man who witnessed the signing. I don't want to reveal your name for purposes of the trial and the witness protection program, so we'll simply refer to you as Vinny J. That's too obvious. We'll call you V. Jackson for the purposes of these interviews. Tell us about your experiences. I mean, what was the witnessing like?
Yeah, I was there. I was there when Quinn wrote the showed Grenda the contract, and you know, Grenda signed it, and Quinn asked me to put my signature on it so that I could witness it. That's how it pretty much went down.
One would think that Mr. Grenda and a person in this position would be nervous about the signing.
He was real cool, calm, relaxed. He knew something was up. He was being real slippery. You know that. You gotta watch him. He's real calm when he does something, up. He's crazy.
Of course, the team did win the national championship, and therefore Mr. Grenda would have to shave his head. Mr. Foley, History Department Chairman, shares his reactions.
You know, this morning, before first period, he told me wherever he goes in the school, he hears clippers in the background. And you know, he said he had a dream last night, a nightmare. A pair of clippers was chasing him through Alapocas Woods. It's unbelievable how much he values his hair.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
In what way does he value his hair?
I think it's connected to his feelings of self-worth or self-image, as a matter of fact.
Really?
Yes.
Wow. Do you share these feelings of importance of hair?
I can't believe this.
He knew. You know that he was going to lose his hair, and I think that frightened him a lot.
He decided to take matters into his own hands. One day, while Quinn was distracted, Grenda snuck into his book bag and stole the contract. When Quinn discovered the contract was missing, he immediately confronted Grenda. When Grenda failed to produce the contract, Quinn immediately filed suit.
He went up and asked him very nicely for the contract, but Grenda refused. So, he had to do what he had to do. He's a slippery one, that Grenda.
For a trial of this nature, Mr. Grenda knew he was going to have to find a top-rate lawyer, and he got one in the form of Matthew Kegelman of the Mathematics Department. We had a chance to catch up with Mr. Kegelman and find out what his opinions were of the impending trial of the century. We've heard reports from various teachers, I won't mention any names, but certain teachers are saying that Mr. Grenda confided in them that he was having apparitions, if you will, of clippers chasing him through Alapocas Woods and scissors forcibly removing his hair. Did he confide any such thoughts in you?
Well, at the time of these horrible nightmares, my client had felt that the entire Model UN team was conspiring to plot against him. And at this time, I can assure you that these preposterous allegations have threatened his credibility, his veracity, and his very livelihood. And beyond the job, the truthfulness, his very word, there was an extra pain and suffering that Mr. Grenda had felt very, very deeply, the loss of his hair. Now, I, more than anyone, should be able to identify with that pain. And I intend to sue any of the perpetrators of this horrible conspiracy plot against my client.
How exactly important was Mr. Grenda's hair to him?
Mr. Grenda's hair is and continues to be his very essence, the essence of Mr. Grenda, the Grenda monster.
Do you share Mr. Grenda's feelings as to the importance and essence of hair? Mr. Kegelman, it was very nice speaking with you, sir. Yes.
We have news that Mr. Grenda will be leaving it with his lawyer, leaving the school building at any moment, and we don't exactly know where he will be or what he will be doing, but we do know that he will be coming out. We hope to ask him some questions for simple... But here he is now, Mr. Grenda! Mr. Grenda, what do you have to say for the television, Mr. Grenda?
Coward.
We're here with Dave Quinn, representing himself for the... trial of the century, come right out of the courtroom here. Dave, what are your reactions to the first day of a trial?
Oh, I believe this whole thing with Grenda here is a complete and utter disgrace to the entire school. It's complete dishonesty, but I do believe that I will be getting a verdict in my favor.
What is your personal opinion of Mr. John Grenda?
Grenda, I'll tell you, that's one slippery character if I ever saw one.
For Mr. Grenda himself, it was becoming harder and harder to live a personal life. One day, while leaving school, he was attacked by a braggart. Due to his amazing self-defense capabilities, he was able to escape unscathed. Pandemonium broke loose when Model UN member Gene Zelak came forward with a copy of the contract he had made for security purposes. He swore to use this in court and thought it would help the case against Grenda.
This contract, that this supposed copy you possess, Mr. Grenda is claiming that it's a forgery.
It's not a forgery. It's a copy of the contract that Mr. Grenda signed, which was seen by witnesses of age, and it's just a photocopy. It should hold up in any court of law.
Do you feel that the courts will administer such evidence? I mean, a photostatic copy of a piece of paper allegedly signed by a social studies teacher.
Mr. Grenda signed the document, and this is photographic proof.
Do you think that Mr. Grenda will be able to weasel his way out of this sort of thing? I mean, we've been told by certain students, I don't want to mention any names, but certain students have said that he's rather, slippery.
When he's wet? Yeah, I guess so.
Slippery, baby! Slip, slip, slippery. As slippery as a slip and slide on a rainy day in July.
The jury deliberated long and hard. They weighed the evidence. Most of them didn't know what to think. Was Mr. Grenda really guilty? Or was Dave Quinn just a liar with his pants on fire? They thought hard, looked at all the evidence over again, and when all was said and done, there was nothing more to say or do. So they reached a verdict.
Guilty.
So as you can see, justice has prevailed. Well, Mr. Grenda, it appears that your luscious head of hair is going to be removed surgically from your scalp, and, well, all we can say here at WSAL is... Bzzz.
She asks me why I'm just a hairy guy. I'm hairy noon and night, hair that's a cry. I'm hairy high and low, don't ask me why, don't know. It's not for lack of bread, like the grateful dead. Darling,
gimme head with hair, long beautiful hair.
a home for fleas, yeah! A hive for bees, yeah! A nest for birds, ain't no words for the beauty, the splendor, the wonder of my head. Knotted, polka dotted, twisted, beaded, braided, powdered, flowered, and confetti, bangled, tangled, spangled, and spaghetti.
Oh, hey, can you see? Boy, boys, if you can get my hair so short down in here.
Where are you going? I was gonna make espresso.